Clarence. By Bret Harte. Podcast 3 of 6. Part 2. Chapter 1. Night at last, and the stir and tumult of a great fight over. Even the excitement that had swept this portion of the battlefield, only a small section of a vaster area of struggle into which a brigade had marched, held its own, been beaten back, recovered its ground, and pursuing, had passed out of it forever, leaving only its dead behind, and knowing nothing more of that struggle than its own impact and momentum. Even this wild excitement had long since evaporated with the stinging smoke of gunpowder, the acrid smell of burning rags from the clothing of a dead soldier fired by a bursting shell, or the heated reek of sweat and leather. A cool breath that seemed to bring back once more the odor of the upturned earthworks along the now dumb line of battle began to move from the suggestive darkness beyond. But into that awful penetralia of death and silence there was no invasion, there had been no retreat. A few of the wounded had been brought out, under fire, but the others had been left with the dead for the morning light and succor. For it was known that in that horrible obscurity, riderless horses, frantic with the smell of blood, galloped wildly here and there, or, maddened by wounds, plunged furiously at the intruder, that the wounded soldier, still armed, could not always distinguish friend from foe or from the ghouls of camp followers who stripped the dead in the darkness and struggled with the dying. A shot or two heard somewhere in that obscurity counted as nothing with the long fusillade that had swept it in the daytime. The passing of a single life, more or less, amounted to little in the long roll call of the day's slaughter. But with the first beams of the morning sun and the slowly moving relief detail from the camp came a weird half-resurrection of that ghastly field. Then it was that the long rays of sunlight, streaming away a mile beyond the battle line, pointed out the first harvest of the dead where the reserves had been posted. There they lay in heaps and piles, killed by solid shot or bursting shells that had leaped the battle line to plunge into the waiting ranks beyond. As the sun lifted higher, its beams fell within the range of musketry fire, where the dead lay thicker even as they had fallen when killed outright with arms extended and feet at all angles to the field. As it touched these dead upturned faces, strangely enough it brought out no expression of pain or anguish but rather as if death had arrested them only in surprise and awe. It revealed on the lips of those who had been mortally wounded and had turned upon their side the relief which death had brought their suffering, sometimes shown in a faint smile. Mounting higher, it glanced upon the actual battle line, curiously curving for the shelter of walls, fences, and braced works, and here the dead lay, even as when they lay and fired, their faces prone in the grass but their muskets still resting across the braced works. Exposed to grape and canister from the battery on the ridge, death had come to them mercifully also through the head and throat. And now the whole field lay bare in the sunlight, broken with grotesque shadows cast from sitting, crouching, half recumbent but always rigid figures, which might have been effigies on their own monuments. One half-kneeling soldier, with head bowed between his stiffened hands, might have stood for a carven figure of grief at the feet of his dead comrade. A captain, shot through the brain in the act of mounting a wall, lay sideways half across it, his lips parted with a word of command, his sword still pointing over the barrier the way that they should go. But it was not until the sun had mounted higher that it struck the central horror of the field and seemed to linger there in dazzling persistence, now and then returning to it in startling flashes that it might be seen of men and those who brought succor. A tiny brook had run obliquely near the battle line. It was here that, the night before the battle, friend and foe had filled their canteens side by side with soldierly recklessness or perhaps a higher instinct, purposely ignoring each other's presence. It was here that the wounded had afterwards crept, crawled, and dragged themselves. Here they had pushed, wrangled, striven, and fought for a draught of that precious fluid which assuaged the thirst of their wounds or happily put them out of their misery forever. Here overborne, crushed, suffocated. By numbers, pouring their own blood into the flood, and tumbling after it with their helpless bodies, they dammed the stream, until recoiling, red and angry, it had burst its banks and overflowed the cotton field in a broad pool that now sparkled in the sunlight. But below this human dam a mile away where the brook still crept sluggishly, the ambulance horses sniffed and started from it. The detail moved on slowly, doing their work expeditiously, and apparently callously, but really only with that mechanical movement that saves emotion. Only once they were moved to an outbreak of indignation, the discovery of the body of an officer whose pockets were turned inside out, but whose hand was still tightly grasped on his buttoned waistcoat, as if resisting the outrage that had been done while still in life. As the men disengaged the stiffened hand, something slipped from the waistcoat to the ground. The corporal picked it up and handed it to his officer. It was a sealed packet. The officer received it with the carelessness which long experience of these pathetic missives from the dying to their living relations had induced, and dropped it in the pocket of his tunic, with the half dozen others that he had picked up that morning, and moved on with the detail. A little further on they halted, in the attitude of attention, as a mounted officer appeared, riding slowly down the line. There was something more than the habitual respect of their superior in their faces as he came forward. For it was the general who had commanded the brigade the day before, the man who had leaped with one bound into the foremost rank of military leaders. It was his invincible spirit that had led the advance, held back defeat against overwhelming numbers, sustained the rally, impressed his subordinate officers with his own undeviating purpose, and even infused them with an almost superstitious belief in his destiny of success. It was this man who had done what it was deemed impossible to do, what even at the time it was thought unwise and unstrategic to do, who had held a weak position, of apparently no importance, under the mandate of an incomprehensible order from his superior, which at best asked only for a sacrifice and was rewarded with a victory. He had decimated his brigade, but the wounded and dying had cheered him as he passed, and the survivors had pursued the enemy until the bugle called them back. For such a record he looked still too young and scholarly, albeit his handsome face was dark and energetic, and his manner taciturn. His quick eye had already caught sight of the rifled body of the officer, and contracted. As the captain of the detail saluted him, he said curtly, "I thought the orders were to fire upon anyone desecrating the dead." "They are, General, but the hyenas don't give us a chance. That's all yonder poor fellow saved from their claws," replied the officer, as he held up the sealed packet. "It has no address." The general took it, examined the envelope, thrust it into his belt, and said, "I will take charge of it." The sound of horses' hoofs came from the rocky roadside beyond the brook. Both men turned. A number of field officers were approaching. "The division staff," said the captain, in a lower voice, falling back. They came slowly forward, a central figure on a gray horse leading here as in history. A short, thick-set man with a grizzled beard closely cropped around an inscrutable mouth, and the serious formality of a respectable country deacon in his aspect, which even the major general's blazon on the shoulder strap of his loose tunic on his soldierly seat in the saddle could not entirely obliterate. He had evidently perceived the general of brigade, and quickened his horse as the latter drew up. The staff followed more leisurely, but still with some curiosity, to witness the meeting of the first general of the army with the youngest. The division general saluted, but almost instantly withdrew his leathern gauntlet, and offered his bared hand to the brigadier. The words of heroes are scant. The drawn-up detail, the waiting staff listened. This was all they heard. "Halleck tells me you're from California."
"Yes, General."
"Ah. I lived there, too, in the early days. Wonderful country. Developed greatly since my time, I suppose."
"Yes, General.
Great resources, finest wheat-growing country in the world, sir. You don't happen to know what the actual crop was this year?"
"Hardly, General, but something enormous."
"Yes, I have always said it would be. Have a cigar." He handed his cigar case to the brigadier. Then he took one himself, lighted it at the smoldering end of the one he had taken from his mouth, was about to throw the stump carelessly down, but, suddenly recollecting himself, leaned over his horse, and dropped it carefully a few inches away from the face of a dead soldier. Then, straightening himself in the saddle, he shoved his horse against the brigadier, moving him a little further on, while a slight movement of his hand kept the staff from following. "A heavy loss here.
I'm afraid so, General. It couldn't be helped. We had to rush in your brigade to gain time, and occupy the enemy, until we could change front. The young general looked at the shrewd, cold eyes of his chief. Change front, he echoed. Yes. Before a gun was fired, we discovered that the enemy was in complete possession of all our plans, and knew every detail of our forward movement. All had to be changed. The younger man now instantly understood the incomprehensible order of the day before. The general of division continued, with his first touch of official formality. You understand, therefore, General Brandt, that in the face of this extraordinary treachery, the utmost vigilance is required, and a complete surveillance of your camp followers and civilians, to detect the actual spy within our lines, or the traitor we are harboring, who has become possessed of this information. You will overhaul your brigade, and weed out all suspects, and in the position which you are to take tomorrow, and the plantation you will occupy, you will see that your private quarters, as well as your lines, are cleared of all but those you can vouch for. He reined in his horse, again extended his hand, saluted, and rejoined his staff. Brigadier General Clarence Brandt remained for a moment with his head bent in thoughtful contemplation of the coolness of his veteran chief under this exciting disclosure, and the strategy with which he had frustrated the traitor's success. Then his eye caught the sealed packet in his belt. He mechanically drew it out, and broke the seal. The envelope was filled with papers and memorandums. But as he looked at them, his face darkened and his brow knit. He glanced quickly around him. The staff had trotted away, the captain and his detail were continuing their work at a little distance. He took a long breath, for he was holding in his hand a tracing of their camp, even of the position he was to occupy tomorrow, and a detailed account of the movements, plans, and force of the whole division as had been arranged in council of war the day before the battle. But there was no indication of the writer or his intentions. He thrust the papers hurriedly back into the envelope, but placed it, this time, in his breast. He galloped towards the captain. Let me see again the officer from whom you took that packet. The captain led him to where the body lay, with others, extended more decently on the grass awaiting removal. General Brandt with difficulty repressed an ejaculation. Why, it's one of our own men, he said quickly. Yes, General. They say it's Lieutenant Wainwright, a regular, of the Paymaster General's department. Then what was he doing here? Asked General Brandt sternly. I can't make out, sir, unless he went into the last advance as a volunteer. Wanted to see the fight, I suppose. He was a dashing fellow, a West Pointer and a Southerner, too, a Virginian. A Southerner, echoed Brandt quickly. Yes, sir. Search him again, said Brandt quietly. He had recovered his usual coolness, and as the captain again examined the body, he took out his tablets and wrote a few lines. It was an order to search the quarters of Lieutenant Wainwright and bring all papers, letters, and documents to him. He then beckoned one of the detail towards him. Take that to the provost marshal at once. Well, captain, he added calmly, as the officer again approached him, what do you find? Only this, sir, returned the captain, with a half-smile, producing a small photograph. I suppose it was overlooked, too. He handed it to Brandt. There was a sudden fixing of his commanding officer's eyes, but his face did not otherwise change. It's the usual find, General. Always a photograph. But this time a handsome woman. Very, said Clarence Brandt quietly. It was the portrait of his own wife. Chapter 2. Nevertheless, so complete was his control of voice and manner that, as he rode on to his quarters, no one would have dreamed that General Brandt had just looked upon the likeness of the wife from whom he had parted in anger 4 years ago. Still less would they have suspected the strange fear that came upon him that in some way she was connected with the treachery he had just discovered. He had heard from her only once, and then through her late husband's lawyer, in regard to her Californian property, and believed that she had gone to her relations in Alabama, where she had identified herself with the Southern cause, even to the sacrifice of her private fortune. He had heard her name mentioned in the Southern press as a fascinating society leader, and even coadjutrix of Southern politicians, but he had no reason to believe that she had taken so active or so desperate a part in the struggle. He tried to think that his uneasiness sprang from his recollection of the previous treachery of Captain Pinckney, and the part that she had played in the Californian conspiracy, although he had long since acquitted her of the betrayal of any nearer trust. But there was a fateful similarity in the two cases. There was no doubt that this Lieutenant Wainwright was a traitor in the camp, that he had succumbed to the usual sophistry of his class in regard to his superior allegiance to his native state. But was there the inducement of another emotion, or was the photograph only the souvenir of a fascinating priestess of rebellion, whom the dead man had met? There was perhaps less of feeling than scorn in the first suggestion, but he was nevertheless relieved when the provost marshal found no other incriminating papers in Wainwright's effects. Nor did he reveal to the division general the finding of the photograph. It was sufficient to disclose the work of the traitor without adding what might be a clue to his wife's participation in it, near or remote. There was risk enough in the former course which his duty made imperative. He hardly dared to think of the past day's slaughter, which there was no doubt now had been due to the previous work of the spy, and how his brigade had been selected by the irony of fate to suffer for and yet retrieve it. If she had had a hand in this wicked plot, ought he to spare her? Or was his destiny and hers to be thus monstrously linked together? Luckily, however, the expiation of the chief offender and the timely discovery of his papers enabled the division commander to keep the affair discreetly silent, and to enjoin equal secrecy on the part of Brandt. The latter, however, did not relax his vigilance, and after the advance the next day he made a minute inspection of the ground he was to occupy, its approaches and connections with the outlying country, and the rebel lines, increased the stringency of picket and sentry regulations, and exercised a rigid surveillance of noncombatants and civilians within the lines, even to the lowest cantiner or camp follower. Then he turned his attention to the house he was to occupy as his headquarters. It was a fine specimen of the old colonial planter's house, with its broad veranda, its great detached offices and negro quarters, and had, thus far, escaped the ravages and bleeding of the war. It had been occupied by its owner up to a few days before the engagement, and so great had been the confidence of the enemy in their success that it had been used as the Confederate headquarters on the morning of the decisive battle. Jasmine and rose, unstained by the sulfur of gunpowder, twined around its ruined columns and half hid the recessed windows. The careless flower garden was still in its unkempt and unplucked luxuriance, the courtyard before the stables alone showed marks of the late military occupancy, and was pulverized by the uneasy horse hoofs of the waiting staff. But the mingled impress of barbaric prodigality with patriarchal simplicity was still there in the domestic arrangements of a race who lived on half-equal familiarity with strangers and their own servants. The Negro servants still remained, with a certain cat-like fidelity to the place, and adapted themselves to the northern invaders with a childlike enjoyment of the novelty of change. Brandt, nevertheless, looked them over with an experienced eye, and satisfied himself of their trustworthiness. There was the usual number of boys, gray-haired and grizzled in body service, and the mammies and aunties of the kitchen. There were two or three rooms in the wing which still contained private articles, pictures and souvenirs of the family, and a young lady's boudoir, which Brandt, with characteristic delicacy, kept carefully isolated and intact from his military household, and accessible only to the family servants. The room he had selected for himself was nearest it, a small, plainly furnished apartment, with an almost conventual simplicity in its cold, white walls and draperies, and the narrow, nun-like bed. It struck him that it might have belonged to some prim elder daughter or maiden aunt, who had acted as housekeeper, as it commanded the wing and servants' offices, with easy access to the central hall. There followed a week of inactivity in which Brandt felt a singular resemblance in this southern mansion to the old casa at Robles. The afternoon shadows of the deep verandas recalled the old monastic gloom of the Spanish house, which even the presence of a lounging officer or waiting orderly could not entirely dissipate, and the scent of the rose and jasmine from his windows overcame him with sad memories. He began to chafe under this inaction, and long again for the excitement of the march and bivouac, in which, for the past 4 years, he had buried his past. He was sitting one afternoon alone before his reports and dispatches, when this influence seemed so strong that he half impulsively laid them aside to indulge in a long reverie. He was recalling his last day at Robles, the early morning duel with Pinckney, the return to San Francisco, and the sudden resolution which sent him that day across the continent to offer his services to the government. He remembered his delay in the western town, where a volunteer regiment was being recruited, his entrance into it as a private, his rapid selection, through the force of his sheer devotion and intelligent concentration, to the captaincy of his company, his swift promotion on hard-fought fields to the head of the regiment, and the singular success that had followed his resistless energy, which left him no time to think of anything but his duty. The sudden intrusion of his wife upon his career now, even in this accidental and perhaps innocent way, had seriously unsettled him. The shadows were growing heavier and deeper. It lacked only a few moments of the sunset bugle, when he was recalled to himself by that singular instinctive consciousness, common to humanity, of being intently looked at. He turned quickly, the door behind him closed softly. He rose and slipped into the hall. The tall figure of a woman was going down the passage. She was erect and graceful, but, as she turned towards the door leading to the offices, he distinctly saw the gaudily turbaned head and black silhouette of a negress. Nevertheless, he halted a moment at the door of the next room. "See who that woman is who has just passed, Mr. Martin. She doesn't seem to belong to the house." The young officer rose, put on his cap, and departed. In a few moments he returned. "Was she tall, sir, of a good figure, and very straight?" "Yes. She is a servant of our neighbors, the Manleys, who occasionally visits the servants here. A mulatto, I think," Brandt reflected. Many of the mulattoes and negresses were of good figure, and the habit of carrying burdens on their heads gave them a singularly erect carriage. The lieutenant looked at his chief. "Have you any orders to give concerning her, General?" "No," said Brandt, after a moment's pause, and turned away. The officer smiled. It seemed a good story to tell at mess of this human weakness of his handsome, reserved, and ascetic-looking leader. A few mornings afterwards Brandt was interrupted over his reports by the almost abrupt entrance of the officer of the day. His face was flushed, and it was evident that only the presence of his superior restrained his excitement. He held a paper in his hand. "A lady presents this order and pass from Washington, countersigned by the division general." "A lady?" "Yes, sir, she is dressed as such. But she has not only declined the most ordinary civilities and courtesies we have offered her, but she has insulted Mr. Martin and myself grossly, and demands to be shown to you alone." Brandt took the paper. It was a special order from the president, passing Miss Matilda Faulkner through the federal lines to visit her uncle's home, known as Gray Oaks, now held and occupied as the headquarters of Brandt's brigade, in order to arrange for the preservation and disposal of certain family effects and private property that still remained there, or to take and carry away such property, and invoking all necessary aid and assistance from the United States forces in such occupancy. It was countersigned by the division commander. It was perfectly regular and of undoubted authenticity. He had heard of passes of this kind, the terror of the army issued in Washington under some strange controlling influence and against military protest, but he did not let his subordinate see the uneasiness with which it filled him. "Show her in," he said quietly. But she had already entered, brushing scornfully past the officer, and drawing her skirt aside, as if contaminated, a very pretty southern girl, scornful and red-lipped, clad in a gray riding habit, and still carrying her riding whip clenched ominously in her slim, gaunt-leafed hand. "You have my permit in your hand," she said brusquely, hardly raising her eyes to Brandt. "I suppose it's all straight enough, and even if it isn't, I don't reckon to be kept waiting with those hirelings. Your permit is straight enough, Miss Faulkner, said Brandt, slowly reading her name from the document before him. But, as it does not seem to include permission to insult my officers, you will perhaps allow them first to retire. He made a sign to the officer, who passed out of the door. As it closed, he went on, in a gentle but coldly unimpassioned voice. I perceive you are a Southern lady, and therefore I need not remind you that it is not considered good form to treat even the slaves of those one does not like uncivilly, and I must, therefore, ask you to keep your active animosity for myself. The young girl lifted her eyes. She had evidently not expected to meet a man so young, so handsome, so refined, and so coldly invincible in manner. Still less was she prepared for that kind of antagonism. In keeping up her preconcerted attitude towards the northern hireling, she had been met with official brusqueness, contemptuous silence, or aggrieved indignation, but nothing so exasperating as this. She even fancied that this elegant but sardonic-looking soldier was mocking her. She bit her red lip, but, with a scornful gesture of her riding whip, said, I reckon that your knowledge of Southern ladies is, for certain reasons, not very extensive. Pardon me, I have had the honor of marrying one. Apparently more exasperated than before, she turned upon him abruptly. You say my pass is all right. Then I presume I may attend to the business that brought me here. Certainly, but you will forgive me if I imagine that an expression of contempt for your hosts was a part of it. He rang a bell on the table. It was responded to by an orderly. Send all the household servants here. The room was presently filled with the dusky faces of the Negro retainers. Here and there was the gleaming of white teeth, but a majority of the assembly wore the true Negro serious acceptance of the importance of an occasion. One or two even affected an official and soldierly bearing. And, as he fully expected, there were several glances of significant recognition of the stranger. You will give, said Brandt sternly, every aid and attention to the wants of this young lady, who is here to represent the interests of your old master. As she will be entirely dependent upon you in all things connected with her visit here, see to it that she does not have to complain to me of any inattention or be obliged to ask for other assistance. As Miss Faulkner, albeit a trifle paler in the cheek, but as scornful as ever, was about to follow the servants from the room, Brandt stopped her, with a coldly courteous gesture. You will understand, therefore, Miss Faulkner, that you have your wish, and that you will not be exposed to any contact with the members of my military family, nor they with you. Am I then to be a prisoner in this house and under a free pass of your president? She said indignantly. By no means. You are free to come and go, and see whom you please. I have no power to control your actions. But I have the power to control theirs. She swept furiously from the room. That is quite enough to fill her with a desire to flirt with every man here, said Brandt to himself, with a faint smile, but I fancy they have had a taste enough of her quality. Nevertheless, he sat down and wrote a few lines to the division commander, pointing out that he had already placed the owner's private property under strict surveillance, that it was cared for and perfectly preserved by the household servants, and that the pass was evidently obtained as a subterfuge. To this he received a formal reply, regretting that the authorities at Washington still found it necessary to put this kind of risk and burden on the army in the field, but that the order emanated from the highest authority, and must be strictly obeyed. At the bottom of the page was a characteristic line in pencil in the general's own hand, not the kind that is dangerous. A flush mounted Brandt's cheeks, as if it contained not only a hidden, but a personal significance. He had thought of his own wife. Singularly enough, a day or two later, at dinner, the conversation turned upon the intense sectional feeling of Southern women, probably induced by their late experiences. Brandt, at the head of the table, in his habitual abstraction, was scarcely following the somewhat excited diction of Colonel Strangeways, one of his staff. No, sir, reiterated that indignant warrior, take my word for it. A Southern woman isn't to be trusted on this point, whether as a sister, sweetheart, or wife. And when she is trusted, she's bound to get the better of the man in any of those relations. The dead silence that followed, the ominous joggle of a glass at the speaker's elbow, the quick, sympathetic glance that Brandt instinctively felt was directed at his own face, and the abrupt change of subject, could not but arrest his attention, even if he had overlooked the speech. His face, however, betrayed nothing. It had never, however, occurred to him before that his family affairs might be known, neither had he ever thought of keeping them a secret. It seemed so purely a personal and private misfortune, that he had never dreamed of its having any public interest. And even now he was a little ashamed of what he believed was his sensitiveness to mere conventional criticism, which, with the instinct of a proud man, he had despised. He was not far wrong in his sardonic intuition of the effect of his prohibition upon Miss Faulkner's feelings. Certainly that young lady, when not engaged in her mysterious occupation of arranging her uncle's effects, occasionally was seen in the garden, and in the woods beyond. Although her presence was the signal for the oblique of any lounging shoulder strap, or the vacant front of a posted sentry, she seemed to regard their occasional proximity with less active disfavor. Once, when she had mounted the wall to gather a magnolia blossom, the chair by which she had ascended rolled over, leaving her on the wall. At a signal from the guard room, two sappers and miners appeared carrying a scaling ladder, which they placed silently against the wall, and as silently withdrew. On another occasion, the same spirited young lady, whom Brandt was satisfied would have probably imperiled her life under fire in devotion to her cause, was brought ignominiously to bay in the field by that most appalling of domestic animals, the wandering and untrammeled cow. Brandt could not help smiling as he heard the quick, harsh call to turn out, guard, saw the men march stolidly with fixed bayonets to the vicinity of the affrighted animal, who fled, leaving the fair stranger to walk shamefacedly to the house. He was surprised, however, that she should have halted before his door, and with tremulous indignation, said, "I thank you, sir, for your chivalrousness in turning a defenseless woman into ridicule." "I regret, Miss Faulkner," began Brandt gravely, "that you should believe that I am able to control the advances of farmyard cattle as easily as—" But he stopped, as he saw that the angry flash of her blue eyes, as she darted past him, was set in tears. A little remorseful on the following day, he added a word to his ordinary cap lifting when she went by, but she retained a reproachful silence. Later in the day, he received from her servant a respectful request for an interview, and was relieved to find that she entered his presence with no trace of her former aggression, but rather with the resignation of a deeply injured, yet not entirely unforgiving, woman. "I thought," she began coldly, "that I ought to inform you that I would probably be able to conclude my business here by the day after tomorrow, and that you would then be relieved of my presence. I am aware indeed," she added, bitterly, "I could scarcely help perceiving, that it has been an exceedingly irksome one." "I trust," began Brandt coldly, "that no gentleman of my command has—" "No," she interrupted him quickly, with a return of her former manner, and a passionate sweep of the hand. "Do you suppose for a moment that I am speaking, that I am even thinking of them? What are they to me? Thank you. I am glad to know that they are nothing, and that I may now trust that you have consulted my wishes, and have reserved your animosity solely for me," returned Brandt quietly. "That being so, I see no reason for your hurrying your departure in the least." She rose instantly. "I have," she said slowly, controlling herself with a slight effort, "found someone who will take my duty off my hands. She is a servant of one of your neighbors who is an old friend of my uncle's. The woman is familiar with the house, and our private property. I will give her full instructions to act for me, and even an authorization in writing, if you prefer it. She is already in the habit of coming here, but her visits will give you very little trouble. And, as she is a slave, or, as you call it, I believe, a chattel, she will be already quite accustomed to the treatment which her class are in the habit of receiving from northern hands." Without waiting to perceive the effect of her Parthian shot, she swept proudly out of the room. "I wonder what she means," mused Brandt, as her quick step died away in the passage. "One thing is certain, a woman like that is altogether too impulsive for a spy." Later, in the twilight, he saw her walking in the garden. There was a figure at her side. A little curious, he examined it more closely from his window. It was already familiar to him, the erect, shapely form of his neighbor's servant. A thoughtful look passed over his face as he muttered, "So this is to be her deputy." Chapter 3. Called to a general council of officers at divisional headquarters the next day, Brandt had little time for further speculation regarding his strange guest, but a remark from the division commander, that he preferred to commit the general plan of a movement then under discussion to their memories rather than to written orders in the ordinary routine, seemed to show that his chief still suspected the existence of a spy. He, therefore, told him of his late interview with Miss Faulkner, and her probable withdrawal in favor of a mulatto neighbor. The division commander received the information with indifference. "They're much too clever to employ a hussy like that, who shows her hand at every turn, either as a spy or a messenger of spies, and the mulattoes are too stupid, to say nothing of their probable fidelity to us. No, General, if we are watched, it is by an eagle, and not a mockingbird. Miss Faulkner has nothing worse about her than her tongue, and there isn't the racial expletive blood in the whole South that would risk a noose for her, or for any of their masters or mistresses." It was, therefore, perhaps, with some mitigation of his usual critical severity that he saw her walking before him alone in the lane as he rode home to quarters. She was apparently lost in a half-impatient, half-moody reverie, which even the trotting hoofbeats of his own and his orderly's horse had not disturbed. From time to time she struck the myrtle hedge beside her with the head of a large flower which hung by its stalk from her listless hands, or held it to her face as if to inhale its perfume. Dismissing his orderly by a side path, he rode gently forward, but, to his surprise, without turning or seeming to be aware of his presence, she quickened her pace, and even appeared to look from side to side for some avenue of escape. If only to mend matters, he was obliged to ride quickly forward to her side, where he threw himself from his horse, flung the reins on his arm, and began to walk beside her. She at first turned a slightly flushed cheek away from him, and then looked up with a purely simulated start of surprise. "I am afraid," he said gently, "that I am the first to break my own orders in regard to any intrusion on your privacy. But I wanted to ask you if I could give you any aid whatever in the change you think of making." He was quite sincere, had been touched by her manifest disturbance, and, despite his masculine relentlessness of criticism, he had an intuition of feminine suffering that was in itself feminine. "Meaning, that you are in a hurry to get rid of me," she said curtly, without raising her eyes. "Meaning that I only wish to expedite a business which I think is unpleasant to you, but which I believe you have undertaken from unselfish devotion." The scant expression of a reserved nature is sometimes more attractive to women than the most fluent vivacity. Possibly there was also a melancholy grace in this sardonic soldier's manner that affected her, for she looked up, and said impulsively, "You think so?" But he met her eager eyes with some surprise. "I certainly do," he replied more coldly. "I can imagine your feelings on finding your uncle's home in the possession of your enemies, and your presence under the family roof only a sufferance. I can hardly believe it a pleasure to you, or a task you would have accepted for yourself alone. But," she said, turning towards him wickedly, "what if I did it only to excite my revenge? What if I knew it would give me courage to incite my people to carry war into your own homes, to make you of the North feel as I feel, and taste our bitterness?" "I could easily understand that, too," he returned, with listless coldness, "although I don't admit that revenge is an unmixed pleasure, even to a woman." "A woman," she repeated indignantly. "There is no sex in a war like this." "You are spoiling your flower," he said quietly. "It is very pretty, and a native one, too, not an invader, or even transplanted. May I look at it?" She hesitated, half recoiling for an instant, and her hand trembled. Then, suddenly and abruptly she said, with a hysteric little laugh, "Take it, then," and almost thrust it in his hand. It certainly was a pretty flower, not unlike a lily in appearance, with a bell-like cup and long anthers covered with a fine pollen, like red dust. As he lifted it to his face, to inhale its perfume, she uttered a slight cry, and snatched it from his hand. "There," she said, with the same nervous laugh. "I knew you would, I ought to have warned you. The pollen comes off so easily, and leaves a stain. And you've got some on your cheek. Look," she continued, taking her handkerchief from her pocket and wiping his cheek, "see there." The delicate cambric showed a blood-red streak. "It grows in a swamp," she continued, in the same excited strain, "we call it dragon's teeth, like the kind that was sown in the story, you know. We children used to find it, and then paint our faces and lips with it. We called it our rouge. I was almost tempted to try it again when I found it just now. It took me back so to the old times." Following her odd manner rather than her words, as she turned her face towards him suddenly, Brant was inclined to think that she had tried it already, so scarlet was her cheek. But it presently paled again under his cold scrutiny. "You must miss the old times," he said calmly. "I am afraid you found very little of them left, except in these flowers." "And hardly these," she said bitterly. "Your troops had found a way through the marsh, and had trampled down the bushes." Brant's brow clouded. He remembered that the brook, which had run red during the fight, had lost itself in this marsh. It did not increase his liking for this beautiful but blindly vicious animal at his side, and even his momentary pity for her was fading fast. She was incorrigible. They walked on for a few moments in silence. "You said," she began at last, in a gentler and even hesitating voice, "that your wife was a southern woman." He checked an irritated start with difficulty. "I believe I did," he said coldly, as if he regretted it. "And of course you taught her your gospel, the gospel according to Saint Lincoln." "Oh, I know," she went on hurriedly, as if conscious of his irritation and seeking to allay it. "She was a woman and loved you, and thought with your thoughts and saw only with your eyes." "Yes, that's the way with us, I suppose we all do it," she added bitterly. "She had her own opinions," said Brant briefly, as he recovered himself. Nevertheless, his manner so decidedly closed all further discussion that there was nothing left for the young girl but silence. But it was broken by her in a few moments in her old contemptuous voice and manner. "Pray don't trouble yourself to accompany me any further, General Brant. Unless, of course, you are afraid I may come across some of your soldiers. I promise you I won't eat them. I am afraid you must suffer my company a little longer, Miss Faulkner, on account of those same soldiers," returned Brant gravely. "You may not know that this road, in which I find you, takes you through a cordon of pickets. If you were alone you would be stopped, questioned, and, failing to give the password, you would be detained, sent to the guardhouse," and he stopped, and fixed his eyes on her keenly as he added, "and searched." "You would not dare to search a woman," she said indignantly, although her flush gave way to a slight pallor. "You said just now that there should be no sex in a war like this," returned Brant carelessly, but without abating his scrutinizing gaze. "Then it is war," she said quickly, with a white, significant face. His look of scrutiny turned to one of puzzled wonder. But at the same moment there was the flash of a bayonet in the hedge, a voice called "Halt," and a soldier stepped into the road. General Brant advanced, met the salute of the picket with a few formal words, and then turned towards his fair companion, as another soldier and a sergeant joined the group. "Miss Faulkner is new to the camp, took the wrong turning, and was unwittingly leaving the lines when I joined her." He fixed his eyes intently on her now colorless face, but she did not return his look. "You will show her the shortest way to quarters," he continued, to the sergeant, "and should she at any time again lose her way, you will again conduct her home but without detaining or reporting her." He lifted his cap, remounted his horse, and rode away, as the young girl, with a proud, indifferent step, moved down the road with the sergeant. A mounted officer passed him and saluted. It was one of his own staff. From some strange instinct, he knew that he had witnessed the scene, and from some equally strange intuition he was annoyed by it. But he continued his way, visiting one or two outposts, and returned by a long detour to his quarters. As he stepped upon the veranda, he saw Miss Faulkner at the bottom of the garden talking with someone across the hedge. By the aid of his glass he could recognize the shapely figure of the mulatto woman which he had seen before. But by its aid he also discovered that she was carrying a flower exactly like the one which Miss Faulkner still held in her hand. Had she been with Miss Faulkner in the lane, and if so, why had she disappeared when he came up? Impelled by something stronger than mere curiosity, he walked quickly down the garden, but she evidently had noticed him, for she as quickly disappeared. Not caring to meet Miss Faulkner again, he retraced his steps, resolving that he would, on the first opportunity, personally examine and interrogate this new visitor. For if she were to take Miss Faulkner's place in a subordinate capacity, this precaution was clearly within his rights. He re-entered his room and seated himself at his desk before the dispatches, orders, and reports awaiting him. He found himself, however, working half mechanically, and recurring to his late interview with Miss Faulkner in the lane. If she had any inclination to act the spy, or to use her position here as a means of communicating with the enemy's lines, he thought he had thoroughly frightened her. Nevertheless, now, for the first time, he was inclined to accept his chief's opinion of her. She was not only too clumsy and inexperienced, but she totally lacked the self-restraint of a spy. Her nervous agitation in the lane was due to something more disturbing than his mere possible intrusion upon her confidences with the mulatto. The significance of her question, then at is war, was at best a threat, and that implied hesitation. He recalled her strange allusion to his wife. Was it merely the outcome of his own foolish confession on their first interview, or was it a concealed ironical taunt? Being satisfied, however, that she was not likely to imperil his public duty in any way, he was angry with himself for speculating further. But, although he still felt towards her the same antagonism she had at first provoked, he was conscious that she was beginning to exercise a strange fascination over him. Dismissing her at last with an effort, he finished his work and then rose, and unlocking a closet, took out a small dispatch box, to which he intended to entrust a few more important orders and memoranda. As he opened it with a key on his watch chain, he was struck with a faint perfume that seemed to come from it, a perfume that he remembered. Was it the smell of the flower that Miss Faulkner carried, or the scent of the handkerchief with which she had wiped his cheek, or a mingling of both? Or was he under some spell to think of that wretched girl, and her witch-like flower? He leaned over the box and suddenly started. Upon the outer covering of a dispatch was a singular blood-red streak. He examined it closely. It was the powdery stain of the lily pollen, exactly as he had seen it on her handkerchief. There could be no mistake. He passed his finger over the stain. He could still feel the slippery, infinitesimal powder of the pollen. It was not there when he had closed the box that morning. It was impossible that it should be there unless the box had been opened in his absence. He re-examined the contents of the box. The papers were all there. More than that, they were papers of no importance except to him personally, contained no plans nor key to any military secret. He had been far too wise to entrust any to the accidents of this alien house. The prying intruder, whoever it was, had gained nothing. But there was unmistakably the attempt. And the existence of a would-be spy within the purlieus of the house was equally clear. He called an officer from the next room. "Has anyone been here since my absence?" "No, General." "Has anyone passed through the hall?" He had fully anticipated the answer, as the subaltern replied, "Only the women servants." He re-entered the room. Closing the door, he again carefully examined the box, his table, the papers upon it, the chair before it, and even the Chinese matting on the floor, for any further indication of the pollen. It hardly seemed possible that anyone could have entered the room with the flower in their hand without scattering some of the telltale dust elsewhere. It was too large a flower to be worn on the breast or in the hair. Again, no one would have dared to linger there long enough to have made an examination of the box, with an officer in the next room, and the sergeant passing. The box had been removed, and the examination made elsewhere. An idea seized him. Miss Faulkner was still absent, the mulatto had apparently gone home. He quickly mounted the staircase, but instead of entering his room, turned suddenly aside into the wing which had been reserved. The first door yielded as he turned its knob gently and entered a room which he at once recognized as the young lady's boudoir. But the dusty and draped furniture had been rearranged and uncovered, and the apartment bore every sign of present use. Yet, although there was unmistakable evidence of its being used by a person of taste and refinement, he was surprised to see that the garments hanging in an open press were such as were used by Negro servants, and that a gaudy handkerchief such as housemaids used for turbans was lying on the pretty silk coverlet. He did not linger over these details, but cast a rapid glance round the room. Then his eyes became fixed on a fanciful writing desk, which stood by the window. For, in a handsome vase placed on its level top, and drooping on a portfolio below, hung a cluster of the very flowers that Miss Faulkner had carried.